Right.
Satish,
Yeah,
quick
you.
question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Actually, for the past two sessions, I don't think I was able to record. I think somebody is recording it. Can they send the previous recordings to or this recordings to, or should I record it? How does it work?
Actually, I'm not recording it. I told them that anyone who wants to record can record it. So, Manju, Nikhil, anyone who's recorded the previous sessions?
No, I was not able to record it, but somebody is recording it. This session is being recorded. Somebody is coming up. The message is coming
Yeah,
up.
there's some the red button is on. This was not
Yes.
available in the last session. I don't know why.
Yes.
So I'm also wondering what was the reason for this entire thing.
Okay.
Anyway, I'll just check up. When have we have it, we will, like pass it on to you. You are Abhilash, right?
No, Manju.
Other Manju. Okay. Yeah, I think you're not there for the last class, right?
The
The
last
last session.
class was, yeah, I was there, yeah.
Yeah. So we didn't cover much. Actually, what happened was we were having, well, I was having issues with my, Windows operating system. Somehow I went into some some technical sites and tried to get the solution. There was some driver which was creating some conflict. So it was crashing constantly when I was using heavy resources like, videos and audios and everything together for GoToMeeting. So it was crashing and it crashed twice. So we were not able to cover much. So just, what I'll do is I'll just wrap around whatever we did last time so that, generally we have an idea. Okay. Right? I hope others also agree. I don't want to actually waste too much of time on this because we're not even installed. This is like technically the third class, right? So we let's
Yes.
start and let's start off with the Python portion of it. But my intention in telling you the background is that, like it's very important to understand the ecosphere in which you are working, right? And Python is a beautiful interface to work with in this ecosphere, right? Okay. So in a nutshell, program is nothing but, these four stuff which the computer can do: input, output, math, conditional execution, repetition, right? And your endeavor is to make sure that the language which you are programming in with is ultimately breaking down all the instructions into these basic steps, right? So this is what it's summarized here. All your languages, you basically break down your steps into such a small elementary step that it can be executed in one computer operation, right? This is very important a statement. We'll revisit it slightly later. Every word of his, this particular definition, the introduction of Python, like object-oriented, elegant syntax, dynamic typing, interpreted nature, like these are all very important. What is scripting, right? What is RAD or rapid application development? And most platforms, what does it mean, right? So we will talk about all those things. Python availability, more or less all the platforms created have got a port of Python. So it's generally available everywhere. Right. So Eric Raymond kind of summarizes why Python, takes the cake when it comes to, good programming language. Basically, it says that your time is important and Python ensures that your time is effectively used. Right. And this was way back in 96. And we are already 20 years down. I mean, sorry. 20 years down, right? 2016, right? So 20 years of Python. So it's a very robust language. Okay, types of Python. Manju, you must not have seen this. You have C Python, PyPy, Unlint, Swallow. Basically, what I'm trying to say is that Python is available in many flavors, but we have C Python as the main Python, right? So understand that. Otherwise, these are the various kind of things which are there, right? The features. Quickly, simple, easy, free, general purpose, all these words are important. It has got some specific meaning. We will revisit it subsequently, right? But generally, have a look when I'm sending out your sending out the slides to you guys. Go to the internet, check out what these terms mean, because all these terms are very important. Okay, right. Then extensible, embeddable, I had gone into slight more details about it. We'll not talk about it now, but we will, you know, in case there's a doubt, we can have a discussion later. Okay, Python is used for internet scripting, systems programming, user interface, product customization, numerical programming, cryptology, image processing, you know, and nearly every conceivable use, even NASA uses it, right? So it is, I mean, it is extensively used. Google uses it for the search engine optimization. Okay, so you can understand how important it is. Right, the Python standard library is very exhaustive and extensive. I mean, it has got libraries for nearly all the major tasks that you will undertake on a day-to-day basis, right? You have a GUI library called tkinter. You've got, you know, the MySQL, rather not the MySQL, SQLite and IBM databases like DB2. You have native ports for that to interact with that, and you have all kinds of like things like regular expression codecs, date and time, collections, threads, mutex. We will talk about it a bit, right? Once we go into details, Berkeley database, basically IBM's, right? Then you have the zip libraries, MD5 hashing. So all these things are available the moment you install Python. You don't, it's basically what is called as the battery included, right? And the important thing about standard library, it's a beautiful document to read. Python as such is a language which is very readable, right? So if you read the source code, you will be able to understand what is happening in the back in the background, and you will be able to understand the program. That's one of the USP of Python, right? Actually, Python, when you talk about it in a more clear terms, is a philosophy to write code, where your time is respected, you respect the resources available to you, and you are writing programs based on that. And there is something called the Zen of Python. How many people have installed Python?
I have not.
Anyone who's not? Who all have Python, who have not got Python installed? Anyone who has not got Python installed?
Yeah, I did not install it.
That is Manju, is it?
No, I have
Nikhil. Nikhil, huh? Okay. Yeah. So I'll just a sec. Okay, so you can say install. Basically, you have to download the site. And basically, you have python.org/downloads. This is the place from where you're supposed to download and install. What's the operating system you're working on?
Windows.
Windows. So you can download either of the version. What is the difference when you have different versions like this? Can you see these two? Are you able to see this? No, I think. Right? Able to see this?
Yeah. No.
Okay, so I just give it in the, I want you guys to open this particular. Just sec, in the chat box, I can't see the chat box either. Oops. No, chat box is not available. Okay, so you have python.org/downloads. Go to that site and download the 3.5.1 version. And what about others? Which version are you having it?
I have installed Python 3.5.
Who is this? Abhilash?
This is Abhilash.
Okay. And what about Manju?
3.5.
And Nikhil, you also download 3.5. And Nix? Nix, which one have you got installed? Or
yeah,
you
I have downloaded 5.1.
Say again?
Yeah, 5.1. No, I have already. I have 5.1.
Python, have 5.1. Which one? No, not Python 1. It cannot be Python 1. It will be Python 2.7.
sorry,
or it will
3
be
point,
Python 3.
Yeah, sorry. No.
You will have to, in case you are on Windows, you have to type a Python hyphen V, I think, capital V. Just a sec, let me check up. Yeah, you have that Python. Yeah, you have to type Python hyphen capital V to find out the version you are working on. I hope it is there in your path, Python path. Is it there? How many people have been able to get that Python 3.5 point whatever version you have installed in your result? That should be a chat box. Okay. Who is that?
Manju.
Yeah, I got it too.
There's one more person, caller 01. May I know who is that? Someone who's joined through the phone. One is Abhilash.
Yeah, I have a caller one. I mean, I have connected audio through phone. So that's the reason it's showing this caller.
Okay. That is Abhilash only, right?
Yeah.
Okay, good now. All right. So, just a sec, stop sharing, and then we'll share again. I'll give this, I think this is better. Are you able to see the Python training IQ online? I've changed the method.
Yes.
Okay, fine. I'll just show you what is there. Okay, so this is the site. Are you able to, you guys able to see it?
Yes.
So you have two versions. One is 2.7.11 and Python 3.5.1. So I want you guys to download the 3.5.1 version. So those are not downloaded, right? So once you click on it, you know, like the exe file will get downloaded. This is about 30 MB perhaps, right? Let me see. Okay, I'll not download it now because I'm working on 2.7 otherwise. So not an issue. So, right. So now we have, once you install it, give me a feedback, fine? So those who have already installed, I want you to type this particular, are you able to see this?
Yes.
Okay, just a sec. I would want it as large. Are you able to see this now?
Yes.
Okay, so this is the command you have to type to get the version. I'm working on 2.7.3. Actually, this is an older computer with Windows 10, which I generally don't use. I told you, like, I was using Linux, right? And that has got the latest version, both versions available. Why do we have different versions? Now, that's another question which comes to the mind. By 20 years of Python, and of course, the later versions, everyone understands. But why are we still, like, I'm using still Python 2.7 here, right? Why? Anyone who can give me a, you know, like, kind of a answer for this?
Because it is backward compatible.
3.5 is backward compatible. Actually, 3.5 is not backward compatible. So it is, I mean, so the programs written in 2.7, some of them will not work without modifications to the source code. Okay, so there are two different versions, and it is recommended, like we have been told by the Python Software Foundation, the ones which are actually, you know, is responsible for the maintenance of Python, to teach new people with 5.3.1. But still, they know that we work on 2.7. You know why? Again, this is again the question, main question. It's not backward compatible, number one. What else? Okay, I'll tell you. Legacy code. I think I've told you last time also, those who have attended my lecture. Legacy code. I've already written thousands of programs in Python 2.7. Right? So let's say I'm maintaining those sites, I will have to use Python 2.7. Yes or no? Are you able to understand? But anyone who is creating new programs, should try to create it in Python 3.5. Now, what is the difference between the two? Some very minor differences exist. They are not major differences. Okay. So are you able to understand this? There are not very many. One major difference is that the print function, print, P-R-I-N-T. Can you see my console? The print was a statement earlier. Now it is a function.
Okay.
This is a major difference. Earlier it was a statement or a keyword. Now it is a function. So what does function have in common most of the languages? They have parentheses. What is a parenthesis? Something like, let's say we call, let's make a function C to F. Let's say this is a function. When you do this, this becomes a function, isn't it?
Yes.
Right. So basically, what do you do here? You will say 42, suppose. So you are passing parameters to the function. Am I correct?
Yes.
Earlier, it was nothing but something like this. You could write, suppose, let's say you want to write print, and then hello class. Right? Earlier, you could do this. But now, what you need to do? What you need to do is, you'll have to put a bracket and write understood? Now, since it's a function, you'll have to put parentheses. So this is one of the major differences. Rest of them are very minute, but this small difference makes such a big impact because print is used extensively everywhere. So one of the major reasons why, apart from it, the internals have changed quite a lot, right? Like you have, okay, we will not talk about it, we'll talk about it when we come to it. Got it? But did you understand that one of the major problems which comes is like this. So all your old programs will not have this parenthesis. Right? So it will create problems. So it is not backward compatible, and more importantly, because of legacy code, I would still go in for 2.7 because there are many libraries which are not ported to 3.5 because libraries are written by third party people. Let's say you write some code and you create a library, right? So you will have to know the internals of Python 3.5 to change it into for that version, right? So that is one of the reasons why you have this change, I mean, two different versions, and both of them are being simultaneously developed for the last about 5 to 7 years, right? And they have still not switched completely, right? Okay, let's move forward, right? Zen of Python, very important. Now let's say, okay, so let's go into the Python. There are two things. One is the IDE. The integrated development environment, right? So if you have, you can write IDLE, I-L-E, right? So can you see this? Python GUI. Are you able to see now?
Yeah.
Okay. So I've clicked on that, and now the interpreter comes up. This is called the Python interpreter. We call it the chevron, right? Something like a sergeant stripe. It's called the chevron. So this triple chevron is the prompt for the Python interpreter. So now we have got inside the Python interpreter. Okay. So in this, let's type a command. So all those who have just type this IMPORT. The moment you type the T, it becomes red, which tells you that it's a keyword. Okay, it's a keyword. And you write THIS. So can you see what I have typed?
Yes, sir.
Just a sec. I'm trying to make the fonts bigger so that it's easily. Yeah, can you see this now?
Yes.
Okay, so import this. I want you to type this. and then press enter.
Is this Linux based?
No. This is I pressed the start command, Windows. I'm actually working on Windows right now. I'm not doing it on this thing. Okay, and I did IDLE.
Okay.
IDLE. Can you see the IDLE? The moment if you have installed Python, then IDLE should bring up this particular application, desktop app. Are you able to do this?
Yes.
Are you able to get the IDLE? You can do it's the same thing as Windows R command and Windows, and then you'll have to get the program files and in Windows 7.
Yeah, I got it.
Isn't it? Right. So once you get this, then you this is actually the interpreter. It's an called an integrated development environment. Okay. So that is what is IDLE. And when you write this, this is the fundamental principles that I've been talking about. So can you read it? Beautiful is better than ugly. Right. Now this seems to be very, very random, but it is not. Explicit is better than implicit. Now again, what is explicit? What is implicit? Right. The difference between Rails and many other frameworks basically is in its implicitness and explicitness. Rails is very implicit, whereas Django is very explicit. So anything which Python touches, it becomes explicit. Explicit means you don't assume anything. Don't assume anything. Simple is better than complex. Complex is better than complicated. Now these are all fundamentals, right? You know, principles basically. Flat is better than nested. So okay, go through it in your own times. Just note it down. It is called import this, or the Zen of Python. Okay, let's go back to the slide. Basically, the last point, the Zen of Python. So I was actually trying to show you how to get to the Zen of Python. Right? So understanding the language means understanding its underlying principles. And the Zen of Python is actually a gist of the principles of Python. Okay? So as and when we program, we will revisit that. Okay? Right, moving forward. Once you know what is Python good at, you should also know what Python is not very good at. So one of them is what? Mathematical calculation. Basically, since, if you remember what Eric Raymond's statement said, that machine time is not optimized, your time is optimized. So basically, mathematical calculations are going to take longer. So not very good for long mathematical calculations, because it will take much more time than your C program. Suppose you have multiple core processors and many CPUs. Python is not ideal because memory management is internally controlled by Python interpreter itself. So it is not the optimal solution in case you have multiple core processors. Okay, we'll talk about that also. In C, you can do the memory management yourself. You can create threads. Python also, you can create threads, but you can't schedule it on processors. So that's the reason why you don't make use of extensive use of multiple cores. Then real-time systems, like let's say you want something critical, like let's say your steel factories or maybe nuclear reactors. So you don't use Python because, again, it is not optimally, the machine time is not optimally used, right? So you don't use Python for that. Are you able to get it?
Okay. Yes.
Shall we move forward? Are you able to get all of you, all four? Just a home would, right? Otherwise, I don't come to know you're there or you're able to understand or not. Okay, great. Yes. Fine. Yes. So yes. Someone said something? No? Okay, I move forward. So basically, not very many things that Python is bad at, right? But we should know about its limitation. Now, why Python? Again, now the same question as the features. It's very powerful. It's open source. What is open source? Basically means that The source code is available free. You don't have to pay for anything. You don't have to pay a single penny to get that idle. You have an environment which you can work with. It's very popular. So basically, why popularity helps? Because there will be a lot of people who would have faced similar problems as you are going to be facing, and they have already found out solution, which should be recorded. So how many people have heard of Stack Overflow?
I've used it.
Yeah, so Stack Overflow is your go-to place for most of your problems, right? So, I'll also mention it. The site is Stack Overflow. StackOverflow.com. Now, this is a wonderful site. All my problems, I invariably am able to get my solutions from there. Rather, to that extent that there's hardly questions I need to ask because all of them have already been asked, most of the problems that I encounter. Yeah, so my point is hugely popular translates to more people giving you solutions to your problems. Right, availability. All your platforms have it. Like I work on Linux and extensively on, you know, like Raspberry Pi or BeagleBone Black on other SBCs, the single board computers. It's available. So whatever programs I'm writing in other places, I already have an environment which is, you know, very familiar and something which is a language which I've worked with. So available for on most of the platforms, nearly everywhere. Then it works on all kinds of environment. Environment means your, like you have various GUIs for Linux. You have the Qt environment, you've got the GNOME environment, right? Or you have the LXDE environment, you know, like you have the lightweight desktop environments and stuff like that. And it is available for every one of them. Like it's not that it is restricted to one particular desktop or GUI environment, right? Macintoshes, it's available. It's available for Windows. And lots of it, you have a special interpreter for Windows. It's called the Window something. I'm not very sure. Rather, just like let me just check up Python. No, it's not mentioned here. Win something. Windows Python or something. Okay, I'll just say that actually has libraries. So your native Windows libraries can be used, GUI libraries can be used with that, right? So I'll just tell you before the class ends what's the name of that particular environment in Windows where you can work. Okay, so all kinds of environment. And most important thing, let's get the fun back into programming because it's so easy to understand, it's so English-like that you will be able to see that you will really enjoy programming. And this is the gentleman who has created Python. I'll just give it a second for the lag. He is Mr. Guido van Rossum, right? And he's a genius. And we call him the BDFL. That is BDFL. Or just a sec. BDFL. Basically, benevolent dictator for life. So till the time he's alive, we have given the reins of how to take Python forward to him. And he's doing a yeoman's job, wonderful job. Okay? Right. So what is Python? Let us look more closely into Python. It is, now these are also words which are very, going to be very important. Strongly typed. What is strongly typed? What does strongly typed mean? Guys, anyone who knows what is strongly typed?
If there are any errors, it shows up and it gives you an option to, if you are using models, it automatically generates, shows which things to use. So.
Okay. We don't need to go into that complex of stuff. We will talk in terms of elementary data structures, the primary data structures that are available. So let's talk about characters and strings. Strings and integer. So let's say we have a small variable called a is equal to 10. Okay, so what is a now? A. If I type A, you can follow this along with it in your IDEs. Anyone who's not able to bring up the idle, please tell me. Okay. So now I'm going to use a function, and the function logically is called type, type, and I'm going to give it a parameter called A, the variable name, and I'm going to ask it which type is it. So what does it say?
Integer.
Integer. Okay. Got it? Everyone?
Yeah.
So this is what is called the type of that particular integer. Now I'm going to create another integer called B, and I'm going to say that is hello. Is it okay? Now if I do type B, so what should it say?
String.
It will be called str. Basically string, but the name given to it is str. Okay. So what is A plus B? What is A plus B? What should be the answer for A plus B? Now this is the question, which is what is beyond the four basic operations. So we are actually diving into the language per se. So if we do an A plus B, there will be some languages which will say 10 hello, isn't it? Yes or no?
Yes.
But here what will happen is it will give an error, because it is a strongly typed language. Python is a strongly typed language. It means it does not allow for operation between two different types. Got it?
Yes. Got it.
Did you understand what I'm trying to say? So this is what is strongly typed. Okay, when we have come across the error, I want to say, tell you something about errors. Errors, though it is mentioned in red, but actually are your best friends. Okay, so I would request you to try and make as many errors as possible when you're learning. Right? Because the more errors you come across when you learn, the lesser you will be encountering it when you are creating programs, actual programs, when you're working. Isn't it? Yes or no? Got it? So what I'm saying is, understand what these errors mean. So if you see, it says traceback. So the error generates a traceback. Basically, the memory snapshot is being shown to you. So PyShell hash 6. If you see here, we are in the sixth line. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So here it is telling you that we are on the sixth line. Right? And in the six lines, this can be multiple lines also. We will come across that. Right? So in the sixth shell, in line 1, right, it says A plus B. It tells you where the error has occurred. This is the beauty of interpreter. Like I told you, the difference between interpreter and compiler. How many people remember what is the difference between interpreter and compiler? I told you guys to go and look into the internet, Google for the difference between compiler and integer. You remember? Okay, I'll just tell you. That's what I'm saying. That's the reason why I took some time on the fundamentals. I can keep explaining it, but then we are impinging on our time for learning of Python. Interpreter gives you real-time feedback immediately. The moment it encounters an error, it gives you a feedback. Whereas a compiler doesn't do that. The compiler tries to compile the entire file and give you the errors after the entire file is compiled. Right? So this is a major difference. So here you get a traceback telling type error. So that's why it is strongly typed. Unsupported operand type for plus means basically you can't have A plus B. Getting it? Mm-hmm. So is it possible to have A into B? Yes or no? How many people say yes? How many people say no?
No.
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 Interesting, isn't it? Did you get it? What it has done?
Yes, 10 times.
Yes.
Now, yeah, it is printing hello 10 times because 10 into. So this is the beauty of Python. There are certain things which is, I mean, unless you understand the fundamentals, you will not be able to understand the language. Unsupported operand type. So it means that plus and minus may not be available, but multiplication is allowed for the same set of operators. Getting what I'm trying to say?
Mm-hmm.
Strongly typed. So certain things, like if you now look at object-oriented principles, it means that this particular overriding has been made possible. Okay? It doesn't give an error here. Okay, so let's move forward. It is dynamically typed. What is dynamically typed? What is statically typed? Okay, statically typed, how many people who have done C or C sharp?
Obvious.
So in other places, you would have had to say int A, yes or no? You have to declare this, isn't
yes.
it? Once you declare it, you cannot change it. Yes or no? Getting what I'm trying to say?
Yes.
Right? In A, you had to declare it in C and C++, right? In Java also. But here you don't have to declare because you don't know whether it is 10. 10 is integer or string. So if I want a, let's say, str type for 10, how will I do it? I'll say A is equal to, I'm going to put it inside quotes. Got this?
Yes.
So now if I say type A, it will show me str. Why? Because now I have put it inside quotes, so it automatically interprets it as string, right? So if you see what I'm trying to say, it's dynamically typed. I don't, like A earlier was int here. In this place, A is a int. Yes or no? In this,
yes.
A is a string. So you can change it en route. You don't have to say that, no, now it is str A. You don't have to type this. Got it? Understood? Don't worry.
Yes.
You will be able to get it later on, but understand this particular thing, what I'm trying to say. Okay. So str A is not required. Automatically looking at the data which is on the right side, that is a value, it will create a data type. Okay, now what will happen if I say A plus B? What should be the answer now? Will it give an error? Remember, I've changed the type. Now it will not give an error. It will give 10 hello. Because I've changed the type. Yes or no? Now?
Yes.
Got it?
Yes.
Okay, now I make a change to B. Now B was a string. Again, I've kept it as a string. 12. Now if I do A plus B, what will be the answer?
10, 12.
A is
12.
A is, should, so how much should A plus B, what should A plus B be?
10, 12.
10, 12.
What the best? Yeah. 1012. Basically, it is concatenating the string. So A is a concatenation operation if both of them are strings. Understood?
Yes.
Are you able to get it, Manju, Nikhil, Nix, Avilash?
Yeah.
Because this is important.
Yes.
Understand, now we are talking about
yes,
the data types. So understand how Python is going to, and all of them are mentioned here in the slide. So under this, I'll send it to you guys. Right? Just you yourself try various operations. Come and make mistakes. No problems. No problems. Okay? No problems making mistakes because those mistakes are going to teach you. So dynamically typed, strongly typed. So you understand all these specific meanings. What does it mean? Now, Python uses duck typing. What is duck typing? So this will come across. We'll talk about it later. So the fundamental principle for this is if it quacks like a duck, if it walks like a duck, it is a duck, right? So let's say, okay, let's not give an example for this. We'll come to it when we come across it, right? So basically, it will interpret it in a different manner. In this case, we have not explicitly mentioned hello to be a, like in this case, like let's talk about this person. So can you see B is equal to quote unquote 12? Yes or no? Now, though this is a number, but since you have put quotes and it behaves like a string, so it is used as a string here. It is not doing a 10 plus 2. So if I want that, we will have to do the typecasting. We'll talk about it later. So basically, this, though being a number, it is interpreted as a str, str type. Okay. So that is kind of duck typing. General purpose. What is basically being used for everything, right? All kinds of operations. Interpreted. So I told you a bit of about it because it is giving you a real-time feedback every time, isn't it? So that is one of the meaning of interpreted. Whereas if it was a compiled language, the entire thing will get compiled and it will tell you all the errors which have occurred. Python is like English. So if you see, most of the things which we'll be writing will be in English, right? You'll have for loops and decisions and stuff like that. Decision is if, else. So it is all like English. It's very readable. So when we see big programs, you will realize that you will be easily able to read it, right? So white space to delimit code blocks. We'll talk about code blocks slightly later. There are certain operations which require that you have those braces in, let's say C or in C sharp or Java. But in our case, we don't use braces, right? Braces basically means the curly brackets. Okay. We use white space. So what does that mean? I'll just tell you. So suppose let's say I write for I in range 10. Okay, so it is very readable, yes or no? So I do this,
yes.
Print, right, print I. What is it going to do?
Print 10 times.
It is supposed, yeah, it will print it how many times?
10
and
times.
I put I. I is what? I is a variable or a constant?
Constant.
It's a variable. And it will take the value from 0 to 9. Okay, we'll talk about it. In this case, it might give an error because, no, it's not giving an error. Good. So, 2.7.3, I think, it has included this print function. Okay, so can you see from 0 to 9 it is printed?
Yes.
Okay, getting what I'm trying to say. So this is how the programs will be written. And if you see, for I, so I is basically a variable, right? And range 10 starts from 0 to 9. So first I will take the value 0, then 1, then 2, then 3. And if you see here, this is the white space we are talking about. So can you see that this has been indented four spaces?
Yeah.
So use white space to delimit code blocks. So this is a code block. So code block starts with a colon. The moment you put a colon, then it will move forward or indent itself four times. Now this is very important, right? You can use white space or tab, but you cannot mix. You cannot mix. So this is going to be very important, right? So many language, if you do any cut paste from some book or something, this is where the problem comes. I'll just give you a small example, right? Let's take this, bring it back here. So I'm putting this one space ahead, right? So what should be invalid syntax? Okay. That's not because of that reason. It is because of some other reason. Just a sec. So I'm bringing it down. So from this is your prompt. Like you have the C prompt or the in Linux you have the dollar prompt, isn't it? So you, instead of making it four spaces, suppose I make it three spaces. Suppose I make it three spaces. Will it work? Yes or no? It will work. Right, it will work. But remember, I'll just tell you one more thing. What will not work is, suppose I write will this work? Here it says unexpected indent. So here this is 4, whereas this is 3, so it will not work. Understood?
Yes.
Getting what I'm trying to say. So this is very important, remember. So I'll take that back again and I push this one, right? So what will happen now? It will work. Understood?
Yes.
So understand, this white space is extremely important, and there are many people who don't like white spaces. So that is one of the negative aspects which is, you know, promoted of Python here. Python has got a lot of white spaces. Now imagine you're writing big programs and every one of them have got these many white spaces. So got that what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
So some people who are the Puritarians, they don't like this. But frankly, this makes the whole code very readable, isn't it? So suppose I want to do something else beyond this. What I'll do is, right now, print.
Yes.
Just a second. Okay, so now I'm going to do a print n. So will this work? Sorry. Again, like the main problem is okay. I generally don't have a big habit of you. Just give me 1 second. Yeah. Because this is what is the problem with idle. You generally don't like to write big programs here because of this exact reason. Right? Okay, just forget it. What I'll do is, I'm going to open a new window. This is again, idle has an interpreter. If you see here, new window, right? That's what I've done here. And I'm going to paste it here. Okay, got this? So I'm going to save it as desktop. I'll name it as first.py. Right? First.py. So now I've got the name of that and I'm going to run it. So if you see run module, it says F5. Okay, so you should read this. This is the menu. In the menu you have got, when you're in the interpreter you don't have it, but when you have the editor. So idle consists of two portions. This is the interpreter portion, okay, and this is the editor portion. So in the editor you have F5. So let me do F5. So can you see now what is happening? Just a sec, let me push it side by side. Okay, so now this is one particular indent, this is another indent. The moment you want to write it, like rest of them are in this loop. Are you able to see this? Guys, are you able to understand and see this?
Yes.
I'm going slightly fast, but then I just want you to, wherever you have a doubt, please stop me. Don't hesitate, right? Whenever you get a problem. So I can put this, I cannot put it like this. That's the only problem, because after four is a what? It's a decision, rather it's an iteration, right? Iteration thing. So once you have this, this will not work. So let me show you. This is not going to like, because this is an error in your program. Unexpected and indented block. So this means that you have to give it an indent. So this is an indent tab. Okay, will this work now? Will this work?
No.
It will work. I'll just show you. So if you see what it has done is, it has done this two lines as a loop, and the 9 is getting repeated because I is the value of I is 9. Isn't it? Yes or no? Are you able to understand this? It's simple. Yes. Actually, I'm using very simple things. But stop me in case you are. Yeah, I will repeat it. What if I push this ahead? Then this forms a part of the suit. The moment we unindent it, it is outside the loop. Remember. Understood? So what I'm doing is I'm putting this outside the loop. The loop ends here. Normally, what will you have? In C and other languages, you will have things like this. Got it? In C, you would be putting something like this. Got it? Yes or no?
Yes.
And here, you don't have all these. You don't have this. What you're doing is, you're using the indentation. Isn't it a smart move? If you look at it carefully, you're indenting it. That's all. You're not using those brackets. And if I push this inside, let's say I push this inside. Okay? So this is again like this. This will be interpreted like this. Getting what I'm trying to say?
Yes.
It will be interpreted like this. You don't require this basis. Rather, the basis won't be wrong to use. Okay. My intention in telling you this is that you remove all those unnecessary braces and you use the white spaces to indent your program. Right? Now I will save this and run it. I'm doing control FI, and you see that it is going to print both all the numbers two times because of the loop. So did you get it? Anyone who is having any slightest of the doubt, this is your basics. Very important to clear the basics first. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, good. So my point is that you use white space to delimit code blocks. Just a second. Right? This is called a suit. Now, if you see, this particular portion is called a suit. This does not, this is another suit, actually. Right? But this portion is your suit. Okay, the grayish portion is your one suit. It starts in the first line with a colon and it ends the moment the line goes back to the previous indent. Okay? Oh, understood? Right.
Yes.
So now next, Python 2 versus Python 3, I've just given you a small brief. You have to use hyphen capital V to get the version number. Okay? How to install? We have already installed. Who was installing it? One of you was downloading and installing it, right? Nix, was it?
No, it's me, Nikhil.
Who is it? Ablash, huh?
Nikhil.
Nikhil. So, were you able to download and install it?
No, I haven't tried it. I'll install it today.
Yeah, so give me a feedback tomorrow because you'll lose out otherwise, right? So please install it.
Okay.
And in case you have any problem, acha, by the way, I want you guys to give me a test mail on this email, right? Just a sec. My email, I'm just writing it here, right? Is it visible?
Yes.
All right. So my name is Satish Vishwanathan, so the first three alphabet of my surname, and yahoo.com. So you, all of you, give me a test mail so that I'm in the position to send you the assignments as well as I can send you the presentation, whatever we have completed. Okay? I also want you to give me a feedback, like what you did not understand, what you want me to repeat or clarify, so that we can, you know, if I have to schedule a separate time for you, I will do that. I want you guys to learn it completely. Understood? Because these are fundamentals, and if you don't have the fundamentals clear, you'll find problems later on. Okay, so send me a test mail after the class, right? And I'll reply to you, all of you, and I'll send you the presentation. Okay, is it fine?
Yes, yes.
Right. Right. So now we have this method to download and install it. I'll be sending it to you, Nikhil. You can look at those thing and download and install it. Okay. Install other dependent libraries. Like you have WX or like let's say GUI interfaces you want to. You can download it from various places. Okay. So we will talk about it. Win32 is a library which is useful for Windows. Right. I don't use it much because I work on Linux. But Win32 is a native library for Windows, the one which I told you. You know, it automatically gives you another IDE. It's called the Windows IDE or something like that. Okay, so we'll talk about it. WX, it's a GUI toolkit like Qt. Heard of Qt? Qt library? It was created by Nokia. Nokia created the Qt library and it has made it open source. So many of your programs, the desktop programs are created using the Qt library. Right. So, and I mean, it's very powerful. So understand that various, all these libraries have been ported to Python. So that is available to you make your own GUI program system. Okay. And then, of course, is set up and there's something called pip, which has come up now. Right. So I'll talk about it in the next class, how you can download and install third party software. What is third party software, by the way? Anyone who can tell me what is third-party software? Okay, third-party, like let's say you guys make some program, okay? Like Nikhil or Nick makes one program and he feels that this will be a very good program. I want to contribute something to the community, right? But it is specifically for networking, right? He's an expert on networking and he's created a module. He wants to make it available. So what Python will do is it will upload it into its site and those who want to download it can download and install it in the existing Python in their own system which is existing. So that is what is basically third party libraries. So a lot of companies and a lot of individuals have created a lot of the software, right, which is available and natively it is not available. I mean when you download Python it is not included with it, but you can download and install it separately. Okay, right, that is what is called third party software. So third party software is generally, it follows a particular format. If you create a module, you need to follow some format, right, and that is used by this ease setup to install it, right. So we will do some installation in the next lecture, right. So today I want to, you know, complete certain amount of quantum of stuff where you can, you know, start off writing small programs. Okay, so pip is the one which I talked about. Pip is Python installation package or something like that. I'm not very sure what it means. But pip is very famous and a very robust tool to download and install. Uninstall everything else. Everything else means the third party. Okay. Right. One more important thing is, like here, if I write Python, Python interpreter will come up, like you have the IDE, but here it is a Python interpreter. Can you see the prompt? So everything that I can do in IDE, I can do it from the command prompt also. So import this. This is the first command we did. So if you see the same thing is available, but in the console.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, your voice is not audible. Like it's the voice is breaking down.
Broken, huh? Okay, I'll say again. I'm saying that Python, if you try just Python here, so you can get this interpreter. Is it audible now?
No, I have same problem.
Okay, I'll just write it down, type it down. Okay, just a sec. Okay. Right, you just have to use the command Python to start the printer. Is it, are you able to see this? When you install Python, you need to use the command Python to start the interpreter in the command prompt or the console. This is the console we are working on. Right, this is the console. Is it clear? So, I will write Python. Is it understood now? So now when I do enter, what will happen? You can get the command interpreter. A is equal to 10. And B is equal to hello.
Yes.
A into B. Here?
Yes.
And then you have to type control B to come out. Right? So control
okay.
D. You have to type control D to come out of the interpreter.
Okay.
Okay, got it?
Got it.
So apart from the idle, you also have this interpreter which you can use from the console. Okay. So we will talk about it in the next lecture, but I just wanted to you guys to have a feel of what it is. So this is apart from the idle. Okay.
Okay.
Right? For this, you have to have the path command set. Let's see the path command. Of course, mine is slightly more complex. Just let me see where is the Python portion of it. Okay, here it is. Can you see where my cursor is?
Yes.
Can you see where my cursor is? C colon backslash Python with a capital P 27 backslash scripts and C colon backslash Python 27. So this is the one which is making Python command available to me. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay, who is recording the session? Anyone who is recording the session?
No.
Okay. No one is recording it actually. Okay. I'll get this thing formally organized. One of you can record it, or I'll try to. But unfortunately, I don't have too much of this space. I'll need to, make some space then. Okay. Next time, next class tomorrow, we will see this. So, any doubts in what we have done today? So, I've given you my mail. I want you guys to give me a feedback on whatever you have learned till now. Any doubts you have, or anything which is not clear to you. I mean, you want me to repeat or something? I can schedule a class for you separately one of these days, and we'll, take out some time as in your time mornings or something, and I'll clarify your doubts. Okay? Right?
Sure.
Right? So, I hope it was okay today. Were you able to understand things?
Yes.
Right? So, now onwards, we'll go slightly faster, and I want you guys to, yourself also. I want you guys to pick up some tutorials on the net and try it now. Right now. And when you come across something which you're not able to understand, hold on, ask me or whatever. I mean, I'm absolutely open to you guys using any material. If there's a major problem, I'll tell you. Right? Otherwise, you go ahead and you also keep pushing yourself in that direction. I want you to surround yourself with Python. Surround yourself with Python. Read Python books. Listen to the podcast. Python podcast is there. You can do a search, right? Listen to Python podcast. Listen to
Is it good?
Say again. Okay, I'll just again mention it here. Surround yourself with Python. Right. use podcast videos about listen to Bite of Python is a good book by Swaroop. Right, this is a good book. Or another beautiful one has learned. Right, I'm not sure of the author, but learned by. So, are you able to see that?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, yeah, just note it down. Note it down, and my intention is to tell you guys to, you know, keep doing something. In any case, tomorrow onwards, once we are more familiar with Python, I'll start sending you assignments, right, which you should be able to do and submit to me before the next class, okay, right?
Okay.
Right. We'll stop for today. Is it okay?
Okay. Yes. Yes.
Okay, guys. So, enjoy yourself. I hope you had a great weekend, and you have a great week now ahead of you. How many people are working? Anyone who's working now?
Yeah, actually, sir. When I try to execute it, I'm getting an error. I'm trying simultaneously while you're saying so. When you enter like print n, when I enter over here, I'm just getting an error.
Yeah. You need to put this.
It's control Z.
You have to put this because now print is a function. I'm using. I'll install by 3.5 here and then we'll use it. But I initially just wanted to tell you the difference between the two. I generally use Python 2.7. Because a lot of my legacy code is in Python 2.7. That's the only reason. Otherwise, like, you know, if you do this, you will not get an error. Okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Right? So main difference 2.7 and 3.5 is this. Now onwards, I'm not going to pick up Python 2.7. I'm going to be using only Python 3.5. Okay? So this is the last lecture with Python 2.7. I basically wanted to tell you the difference. But I'm happy that you guys, at least, you know, the more errors you encounter, the better it is for you. Better it is for you, because you will learn something new. In this case, key a simple thing, but gives you an error, you don't know where to follow, means like, you know, how to follow it. And I'm there to help you guide you in this case, okay? Okay, so tomorrow, same time, today I got delayed because I was waiting in the other one. Now I'm going to make sure that I have this. It's actually an old computer of mine which I'm using. Something which I've not been using much, so, you know, like all kinds of problems come up every now and then. So I hope not to have any problems from tomorrow onwards, okay? Right? Yeah. And I want you to send me the mail, all of you. Send me the mail. Okay, test mail.
Okay.
Okay, bye guys. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.